Good morning, students. Yesterday we had seen how Rome itself was becoming less and less important and less prominent, and the areas which were the occupied areas, the areas which had been conquered, those areas were getting more and more important. That is the areas outside Rome, areas outside outside the proper Italy, as you would call it, in those days. You know, things were happening, a lot of action was happening in North Africa, a lot of action was happening in Asia, that is West Asia, and it is these areas which were contributing most of their military generals, their best businessmen, their best legal minds, administrative minds. So a lot of action was happening in the surrounding areas, but the credit would also have to be given to the Romans themselves, who were always who never felt challenged by the people of other races if they were doing well. You know, they were never jealous about them. They always patronized talent. That is something that is something which emerges in history throughout. You know, if you go through Roman history, they might have had popular emperors, unpopular ones, stupid senators, good senators, you know, all of that was palace intrigues and all of that, you know, backstabbing, everything was there. But for some reason, they were very, very keen in patronizing the talent of the areas and the geographies that they acquired and that they conquered, because they never felt jealous about them. There was no favoritism that only a Roman would be promoted to certain levels, and only a Roman could be a general, only a Roman would be allowed to be, you know, would be patronized, and favorable laws would be made so that only his business flourishes. No. They were very particular about it, that yes, talent, let the talent flourish, you know, whoever can take it, whoever can make it, let them do it. And that is one of the reasons why Roman Empire became extremely prosperous, rich, and it had a huge kind of, they introduced a lot of things, but that is another chapter altogether, and probably we shall see, after a few pages. They introduced a lot of things, whether in writing, whether in sports. That is something which we follow even today, because they had been extremely influential because of their reach, because of the different cultures that they were able to attract, that the different societies that they were able to work with. You know, unlike the Persians, because we are talking about the Persian Empire here, unlike the Persians who were not good at it, because they were more about, you know, their own people, their own culture. But the Romans were extremely good in not just inviting people of varied and different cultures, but also at the same time, they were very good in promoting the talent of those people. They were very good in and successful also in working with them. You know, though they were the conquerors, they never had that kind of felt of that feeling of arrogance that they were to be looked under. Okay, so what we see here is villages could be upgraded to the villages could be upgraded to the status of cities, and vice versa. So a lot of action was happening, and one very important thing, students, which is very remarkable about the Roman Empire, was the culture of public baths. You know, public bath, whereby you have a large water tank, huge water tank, something like large swimming pool, and where everyone is taking bath together. Okay, whether it is hot water bath or cold water bath, whatever it is, you know, everyone is there taking baths together. Different ones for men and different ones for women, but then it was very, very public kind of a thing. And this is something which is a very striking feature, not just of the Roman Empire, but then because the Turks were very close to the Roman Empire. Roman Empire had expanded very much, was there in Turkey, and you know, that culture is there in Turkey even today. This is something when you studied Indus-Valley civilization, you also come across this public bath thing in Mohenjo-daro. Even they had this thing about public bath, and students even today, for example, you know, if you go to, there are all a lot of cultures. Even in Europe, all across Europe, you have this system of public bath, and not just in Europe. Even if you go to Japan today, you would find that they have this concept of public bath. You know, where everyone taking bath together, meeting, having great time, chatting, laughing, merrymaking, having drinks, and that kind of stuff. So it's there even in Japan. Okay, though of course all of them can afford their own bathrooms, they all have their own, of course, but then they don't miss an opportunity for this public coming together and having a bath. So this is a very prominent feature, and that's what is written here. When Iranians also tried to copy it, that is the Persians who tried to copy it, it turned out to be extremely unpopular, because the religious clergy there really objected to this public bath thing and everyone taking bath together. Okay, now we come to the topic, this third century crisis. Now, what is this crisis that we are talking about? In the first and the second centuries, whereby and large a piece of just a moment, whereby and large peace, prosperity, and economic expansion, the third century brought the first major signs of internal strain. From the 230s AD, the empire found itself fighting on several fronts simultaneously. In Iran, a new and more aggressive dynasty emerged in 225 AD, calling themselves Sassanians, and within just 15 years were expanding rapidly in the direction of the Euphrates. In a famous rock inscription cut in three languages, Shapur I, the Iranian ruler, claimed that he had destroyed or killed a Roman army of 60,000 and even captured the eastern capital of Antioch. Antioch is in Turkey, and that used to be the eastern capital of Roman Empire. And so the ruler at that point in time, a very aggressive ruler, the Sassanians, you know, the family of Sassanians in Iran, they were expanding towards Turkey and towards Euphrates and Tigris, which definitely would be in direct conflict with which would make them in direct conflict and bring them in direct conflict with the expansion of with the Roman Empire. That is a whole series of Germanic tribes. All Germanic tribes would mean people from Germany and areas, the northern part of Europe, that is we are talking about. Meanwhile, a whole series of Germanic tribes, or rather tribal confederacies, most notably the Alemanni, the Franks, and the Goths. Franks would be the French, of course, and the Goths, again from the northern part of Europe, began to move against the Rhine and the Danube frontiers. As we had seen right in the beginning of the video when we were studying that map, that the River Rhine and River Danube used to be the natural frontiers for the Roman Empire in the north, because they were massive river systems, and the Roman Empire usually used to ensure that yes, this was the boundary that they would be kind of following. Okay, that was considered to be in north, that yes, this is as far as Roman Empire went. But under some very ambitious and great military generals and rulers, of course, they expanded even beyond these rivers. They used to, you know, they used to go around it, and then they used to, because you have to understand that at one point in time, the Roman Empire used to rule even England. Now, England happens to be an island, much isolated somewhere in the North Sea, but Roman Empire had expanded even till there. Okay, they had gone till France. So under good rulers, you know, fierce administrators, great military generals, they of course used to expand in other parts as well. Now, all of this for the Romans was becoming more and more difficult to control and manage, because what we are seeing here is that people from north part, because Roman Empire was southern part of Europe, students, okay? Now what we are seeing is the people from northern part of Europe, they started pushing the boundaries of Roman Empire, which used to be in the which used to be the northern boundaries for them. They started, those people started putting an enormous amount of strain on the military and the army of the Romans, and they started getting into head-on collision, and great many battles had started happening in the northern areas. The Romans were forced to abandon much of the territory beyond Danube. So as it now says, that because they, you know, Danube and Rhine used to be the traditional northern boundaries for them, and under great rulers they used to go even beyond those rivers, but now all of that had they had lost all those territories, because people in the north, the tribes in the north, that they had started getting into collision with the Roman army, and now and then very fierce people, and they used to have fierce battle, and it was becoming very difficult for Roman army and the Roman forces to control those areas, and they started losing those areas in the north. The Romans were forced to abandon much of the territory, while the emperors of this period were constantly in the field against what the Romans called the barbarians. The rapid succession of emperors in the 3rd century, that is 25 emperors in 47 years. Just that's a mind-boggling number, students. 25 emperors in 47 years is an obvious symptom of the strain faced by the empire in this period, you know. Because there were 25 kings in 47 years, that clearly speaks volumes about how difficult this situation was in Rome as a nucleus, and also how much of a decay that had happened, because there was no ruling family in Rome now which seemed to be having the talent, or which seemed to be having people or the heirs who could actually control this such a huge Roman empire, because no one probably at that point now had the talent, the skill, the charisma, or they were not brave enough, of course, and that is why there was enormous amount of dissatisfaction and palace conspiracies and everything, and that is the reason why 25 emperors in 47 years, that is almost one emperor every 6 months. So imagine that situation, right? So naturally, the other tribes, the people who had been under the Roman rule for a very long period in time, they started asserting themselves. They started kicking out the Roman army from their respective areas. And barbarians were students. This is a very, you know, being a student of history, you must know what barbarian. Barbarian today, we, you know, is considered to be someone who doesn't have those civil manners, people who are very difficult to control, people, those who are very brutal, not at all civilized. They would kill just for the sake of pleasure. So these are the people today known as barbarians. But at that, but in the early years, the definition of barbarian was something else. But then that's another topic. You know, once we meet in class, then we will go about it. Now, gender, literacy, and culture. This is something which we shall see tomorrow. Thank you.